Let's get started with the concepts. So what is in-memory computation and processing? It means that we want to process our data, and all this data is stored in the memory of multiple servers. So you can think about it like having a database that is solely in main memory. The advantage when having everything in memory is that you don't have the need for doing any kind of input-output. That means you will get fast response times, which is particularly important when you do analytics. Disadvantages are that data must obviously fit into memory of this distributed cluster and storage environment, and that you need fault tolerance, which is particularly important when we talk about writing to this solution. So there are a couple of prominent solutions in BA, so in business intelligence, we have SHP HANA, for instance. In big data approaches that are open source, we have Apache Spark and Apache Flink, which we'll talk about today. So let's talk a bit about the data model for data flow programming languages. So the data, you can think of it a bit like having a table or a CSV file, which consists of a list of tuples. And the tuple is basically defined as a set of individual values. So we have here x1 up to xn, where n is the number of the different columns in such a table. It may be that we have a specific type for one of these columns, so that the first element of the tuple could be of type string, for example. The last one could be an integer or date. Okay, now we understand the data, we have to think about how we want to process this data. So typical operators that we want to do with tuples is that we want to map the tuples, or basically run a for each kind of construct. That means we want to transform or process the individual tuples or a group of tuples. So for example, you can think of, you have a student table and you say, please map in this table the column ID and name to ID plus 4 and name. Okay, so that means for each of the tuples we add 4 to the ID. So you could also apply reduction operators for groups. For example, having somehow the students group, for example, by gender or by year they are studying in, you could say, let's count the year. So we apply the count function on this column year. A very common operator is also the filter operator, where we compare a key to values and then basically discard all the tuples that don't match our condition. There are also a set of operations that require the complete input data. For example, you sometimes want to group tuples by a key, like we want to group students by the year of their study. We want to sometimes sort data according to a key, join relations together, or split tuples of one relation into multiple relations based on a condition. But these operations, they are, I would say, a bit more rare than the typical operators, which you can think of the map for each operators and the filter operations. We'll see more about this later. So what is now the data flow programming paradigm? The focus is on this data movement and transformation. So you basically specify a directed acyclic graph of the data flow from the source to the sinks and the operations that happen. So we have here nodes that are input-output or operations, and edges that are basically the dependencies between the input and output. Very similar to what we learned last week about tests, which also represented in this case a directed acyclic graph. Note that some data flow programming languages can actually deal with directed graphs. It does not have to be acyclic necessarily. Okay, so if you compare this approach to the imperative programming language that you know from C, C++, and Java, there you specify the sequence of commands, the kind of the operators that you apply to our data individually. So you say do this with the data, for example, and then you generate new output, or you apply conditions and other operations. Here we really specify processing in our DAG, our directed acyclic graph, and then the system will figure out how to parallelize it and when to run it. So an operation can basically run once the inputs become available. So an operation might work on a single element or on our complete data. It doesn't matter to us. And a key benefit is that parallelism is inherently supported by data flow languages. So far we talked about some typical operators here, like map, for each, grouping, and so forth. Those operators have in common that they are stateless. Okay, that means they do not depend on the state of the overall program. They depend only on individual tuples, or in this case, a group of tuples. So Dataflow works indeed best with stateless programs, but sometimes you need to have some data-related states like data reductions. And in this case, what you need to have is you need to have some kind of persistency mechanism to store the intermediate progress of this operation. Let me give an example. So here's some pseudocode. Let's assume you want to read a file, and this output, so the input from this file, basically gets filtered by scanning the word. If the word is big data, as long as the word is big data, you generate these tuples. Now we apply the reduction operator. We call the function count, which then would, you know, basically count how often the word big data appears in our file.csv file. So now, how does this relate to stateless program? Okay, a filter operation depends only on each, can be applied obviously on each individual token or each individual entry of our CSV file independently. However, the reduction operation, when you count the number of occurrences, you have to remember what was the state of counting. So therefore, you have to somehow remember the state, which means you need to store this information, and to store it in a fault tolerance way, you have to use some kind of storage. Okay. So next I will introduce the concept of pipe diagrams, which is very useful to visualize the processing pipelines of data flows, and also to visualize the schemas. There's also a variant of pipe diagrams where you can illustrate the processing using examples. So here we see an example pipe diagram, and what we have here is boxes are operations. An operation is a function filtering, grouping, aggregating, or mapping of data, and it also can mean input and output, which is basically considered to be an operation, like reading and writing. Okay, here we see input, so we read data, and I also visualize the schema. So we see from this file we expect to get an ID, a first name, last name, if the person is female or not, true or false probably, and the birthday. So that could be something about students, for example. And then we want to group if the person is female, yes or no. And then we want to count, we want to map these groups by counting if the person is female, yes or no. And then we output finally the number of people that are female and the number of people that are not female. Okay. So we also see here the directed acyclic graph, and this one is a very linear program. There is no join. Joins would have more than one input, but this is a very simple program that you are supposed, and I think you will understand. So here is now an example of the same program where we basically have our input table, you know, visualized what it can look like. We have IDs, we have name, first names, last names, and birthdays, and so on. We group, where you basically get two groups here, one where female is false and one where female is true. And after we've done the counting, we figure out there are two, in this case, one female and two, well, not females, basically, or males. Good. So lastly, this idea now blends into stream processing. So the stream processing paradigm is basically data flow programming, however, on smaller chunks of data. Instead of programming it on the whole data sets, we only have access to a subset of data at a time. So let me show that. So we have basically a stream of continuous data where we get an element and then another element and then another element and so on. And now we can perform our data flow programming on top of it. For example, we can manipulate each element by adding the ID of 4, like we said before. So that would apply to this element and to this element and this element and so on. Right? As I said, the key difference is that we don't necessarily have the possibility to access all the elements at one time. Okay? So we operate on small chunks of data. So how do we program this? Well, we have to implement operations, which are called often kernel functions, and we define the data dependencies, like we did in these examples here, with our pipe diagrams and our directed acyclic graph, pretty much. And now, like I said, there is no view of the complete data at any time. There is a special variant of streaming, which is called uniform streaming, where you say that operations can be executed on all elements individually. So that is the pure representation in which you don't have to remember a set of elements, okay? You can operate on this element and on this one, all independently. That's the best case. So advantages of stream processing is that you can pipeline operations and you can achieve massively parallelism. So the data is, when you stream process, typically in memory and often can be cached in the CPU, which allows you to do in-memory computation and really quickly. As at compile time, you do typically know the data dependencies of our directed acyclic graphs, and then you can compute and generate a program which can run efficiently. Okay, so with uniform streaming, when we apply on all elements individually, we have problems, some certain restrictions, right? How would we possibly even count how many elements there are, right? It wouldn't be possible because we can only see a small chunk of data at a time. Therefore, there are a couple of kind of relaxations of the pure uniform streaming model. One is called windowing, where you have basically windows. You can think of, I have here a window every 10 seconds. For instance, I can see only the data of 10 seconds intervals. Okay. Another approach is that you have stateful approaches that keep information for multiple elements. This then allows you to do reductions.